if I can't find words.
Norma and I have been working on this issue for 8 years together. We've been all over the country together. We first met in Arctic Village, Alaska, and I was a photographer, and I think she was about ready to choke me. But since then, Norma and I have become friends, and I think that would be not doing it justice the way I feel about her. Norma is my little sister. We've kind of taken care of each other. We've laughed together, we've cried together. We've done remarkable things together. Her family is my family. She's Vincent's aunt. When I go up to Old Crow, her family takes care of me. I've been out on the land to their bush camp in Crow Flats and during the spring hunting and trapping season. We've been in Ottawa together, we've been in Washington together, we've spoken to Congress together, we've spoken to Parliament together, we've spoken to groups like this together. Norma Cassie is a former member of the Yukon Territory Legislative Assembly representing Northern Yukon. She's a member of the Gwich'in Steering Committee. She's spoken to the United Nations. She's done remarkable things in her life, and always for her people. She's not going to like this, but she's a mother and a grandmother. And I babysat with her little baby. But out of all those things, member of the Yukon Territory Legislative Assembly, all of that speaking to the United Nations, the most important thing to me is that she's my friend. Please welcome the Honorable Norma Cassie.
Thank you, Amy. The Honorable. You guys are the Honorable. Good afternoon, everybody. I ask you for your patience. I know you guys are tired and you've gone through a lot in the last couple of days, but we got a few days more. Consider it good teachings, consider it good counsel, and be grateful. It's just so wonderful to be here, and I want to thank Molly and Chris, where are they, for inviting me here, and I'm glad I was able to make it. Every time I have a look at the slideshow that we've just seen, I become very heavy in my heart because a lot of the old people, the elders that you see in there, have gone on already, and we've taken those pictures just a few years ago. Another thing that I'm really highly emotional about is I'm so proud of my nephew, Vince. He spoke so well and so eloquently. Comes from our ancestors. Our old people in my nation are people of value. We really value their lives. They've given us so much strength, so much wisdom to continue and do the work that we have to do. I've been taught many important values and traditions of my people, and some of it I'll share with you today. It's just a little bit. And I have 25 minutes, and I've been told to stay within that. These perspectives and teachings are not my own. They come from my ancestors, from many years of knowledge that is profound, that comes from generations of staying in one place. They come from friends that I've worked with, young people like yourself. That's where I get my wisdom. The most important, one of the most important values that I've learned through my time is to remember and acknowledge the ancestors who were here originally on this land. And I want you to join me in remembering the original caretakers of this area, who were the Utes, the Cheyenne, the Paiutes, the Kiowa, and the Shoshone people. And acknowledging them, we will be guided through our deliberations in the next few days. They will be around us. And I thank them for that. I'm blessed with 4 children and 2 grandchildren that I have the opportunity to teach in a different way now. My Gutchin name is Guatlaheishi. In our culture, we have Indian names. This name means one who travels far and wide, but his food is good. I carry my great-grandfather's name. To that name, I hold a great responsibility, and a lot of Indigenous people have Indian names that they hold responsibility to. It means that we have partners in the spiritual world that will guide us through whatever endeavors that we may take on in our future. And we must carry that responsibility well with a lot of respect. From the time I was born and before, I was raised on the land, a very special place amongst hundreds of lakes. We're called Vantat Gutchin. I just want you guys to say Gutchin. Again, Gutchin. Yeah. We're caribou people of the lakes. That's what we're called. We lived with animals and birds. We trapped, we hunted. We worked with the elements to survive, sometimes in 70 to 80 below weather. Where only one language was spoken when I was out there on the land was Gutchin. Caribou, as you've seen in the pictures and you've heard from Lenny and from Vincent, being the very essence of our lives. At this point, we have some things I would like to show you, and I'd like Vincent to bring them up here. And I'd like to show you what we use from the caribou. We can't wear these things down here, it's too hot for us. This is a beautiful vest made of caribou hides. And years ago, the beautiful floral designs are flowers that grow in the Arctic, and we put onto our hides and our clothing for ceremonial purposes and wear for special times. And before that, caribou clothing were made all the time. And that's a traditional vest made of caribou hide. These are called crow boots. They're beautiful moccasins that were made specially for Vincent, so that he will be strong in carrying his messages to people as yourself. These are little moccasins that we wear in the wintertime and for our children, and it's made of caribou hide and canvas from trade items that came out to our people initially. These are called Jadrelo Kaichan, which means moccasins that are made from the caribou leg skins, and this is what we wear in the cold winter time in the Arctic. This is what we make our hides with. These were used to be made of stone until we were introduced to metal or bone that are made from caribou bones to scrape and to tan our hides to make it beautiful, like you've seen there on the moccasins in the mess. This is rope that we used to use, and we still do today, that's made from the skins of the caribou. These are small pair of snowshoes for small people, for young people that we make, and this is made from caribou skin, and this is spruce from our lands, and our people make these so that we can travel far on and wide on the snow. And these are caribou horns that were particularly blessed in the Sweat Lodge. so that they can bring power for Vincent when he travels. We have to make a lot of games amongst our culture, and this is also connected to the caribou. What you have to do with this is you have to get these two buttons onto the side. And that shows tremendous skill and patience. Peel off one at a time, and we make thread with it, and that's how we sew our clothes. And our people have given their lives for the survival of others. When we squish out a spider crawling across our kitchen floor, we experience consequences. We may experience consequences of change in weather. We may experience consequences that are even stronger than that if we treated animals that are powerful and that are our kin. We've experienced grave consequences amongst our nations. These are people who have disobeyed the natural laws. I've heard stories from down here that one time the forests were so vast that squirrels could travel across the continent from the east to the west of the United States on top of the trees without touching the ground. Isn't that amazing? And those are stories that are told by the Utes and the Cheyenne and the Shoshone people. We live in the Arctic, where all the geese and the ducks of every species migrate from the lower U.S. and come up to our lands to bear their young, as you've seen in the slides. I remember times when they would return, time of so much joy, our land would just become alive and the skies would just darken with birds. We try to sing their songs, our people sing their songs. I try to sing their songs lots of times, and I notice they laugh at me. They sort of just swim away and they laugh, and I can tell they laugh at me. But when my mom sang their songs, they came towards her. There were massive herds of buffalo that we need to remember that roamed in this land here, as do the caribou in the Arctic. The fish were so abundant, the streams were so full, but down here, in my lifetime, they did end. And with it went many indigenous cultures, not only on this continent, but all over the world. Our people are dying fast, as our resources and our food sources, our medicine plants diminish, so do our people. We have the highest rates of cancer and diabetes amongst our nations. And as we heard yesterday, suicides. Yet man continues to dominate and feels the need to dominate where he couldn't dominate. He destroyed the points to points of total depletion of animal life, fish life, and human life. And so the lessons we should learn continue. We're not asking for pity, nor are we asking for patriotism. We seek understanding and acceptance for our knowledge of what we can share. We need to be listened to. We need to be partners in all decision-making for our future. Because they will never get rid of us. We'll always be here. We believe that the great time, the U.S. military had built 41 distant early warning sites called Dulan sites, of which 21 are now abandoned. The Canadian scientists have conducted soil studies to find within 20-kilometer radius of those sites very high levels of PCBs. And this is the land that we live in and share with the Inuit. We were disregarded when they brought those things to our country. We found toxaphene, DDT, a toxic deadly chemical used to stop growth and was used in the Vietnam War called Agent Orange on pipeline routes along the Alaska Highway that were dumped and left behind. These were used to stop growth along these routes. And of course, and they were buried as well. We're beginning to find this because they're creeping up into our food chain now. And this stuff is known to cause cancer amongst our people. We believe it's known to contribute to the cancer amongst our people. And we wonder why there's so much diabetes as well, because we also have found out that PCB contributes to diabetes. So we try to get the governments to take some responsibility for cleanup. And that's a whole nother big long story that I don't want to get into right now. These contribute to a slow erosion of our traditional lifestyles, of our health, of our culture. Not too long ago, just before I came down here, about 2 weeks ago, in Alaska, a caribou herd called the Western Arctic herd over towards the western part of Alaska, they had found 2,000 to 3,000 dead caribou. They're trying to keep the causes quiet, but we know what's going on. We know what it's from. They are trying to say that they die from natural causes. I mean, give me another break. Because those caribou have lived in that natural environment for hundreds of thousands of years, and we have never seen that kind of mass death with no reason, like they say. This too will be the fate of the Gwich'in. If the oil and gas development is allowed to proceed in the calving grounds of the caribou that we depend on, the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, as you have seen in the slide presentation, is a vital biodiversity, part of that ecosystem that has to be protected. My people will cease to exist if anything happens to that herd. I've been traveling now for 11 years to educate about my culture, about its land and its resources. Just recently, as you have heard, there was another vote in the Senate to open the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge for development, and the senator's vote went 56 to 44. And to the 44 people who voted for us, we are so grateful, and to the 56, we want you to come on board. For your patience, for your hospitality, for your teachings and your help. And in closing, I strongly recommend that we listen and not forget, but to use the wise words of my friend, my sister Molly, from yesterday, to look at alternatives for the future. We have to look at ourselves. To seek change in society's attitude, it starts with ourselves. You leave me with a strong encouragement for the future. You do. I will go home and I will tell my people about this. I will tell them about your dedication to assist in the healing process. Come and visit our beautiful lands. We're welcome to share our tea and our bannock around our fires and tell our stories with you. And one of our strongest value of our elders is live each day like it's your last and be grateful. Masi cho.